As I said, my name is David Briones. It's a joy to be here with you today, primarily because I get to fellowship with you all, talk about the Bible, pray, and get to revel in the riches of Jesus Christ as Lord. So it's an absolute privilege to be able to do that on a weekly basis, and I'm thankful to do it today, especially when I get to talk about one of my favorite topics, which is generosity. But it's much more than generosity, because generosity seems a bit vague. You might have thought, I wonder what he's going to talk about. Is he going to convict me because I'm not generous enough? Or is he going to talk about generosity in the first couple centuries of the early church? Well, let me clarify what I'm going to talk about today, and then we'll get started. I'm going to talk about God in Christ, the grace that he gives, the relationships that are produced, and then we're going to think about generosity. So we're using that sort of as a platform to talk about divine generosity. So to understand human generosity, the human act of giving to another human being, we must, as Christians, think about divine generosity, what we have been given in Christ from God. That seems like a necessary step. So we have to talk about God. We not only have to talk about God, we have to talk about what God gives, which is perfectly summed up in the word grace. So we're going to talk about what is grace. That's one question we're going to ask. And then we're going to talk about what grace produces. What does it do? What does it result in? And then lastly, we'll talk about the relationships of generosity that we have in Christ. And we're going to look primarily at the Macedonians in 2 Corinthians 8 and 9. Macedonians are the Philippians as well as the Thessalonians. And in 2 Corinthians 8, 2, we find this phrase, the wealth of generosity, that out of the depths of their poverty came a wealth of generosity. So we're going to try to understand that and unpack a theology of generosity, so to speak. Hopefully that makes sense, and I will try to keep you with me as I go along to logically unpack all of the riches that are found in God's word on this particular topic. Before we begin, let me go ahead and pray. Father, we thank you for this chance to be able to come under your word. Lord, we dare not stand over it. We don't examine your word as some specimen that has no connection to real life, to the way that we think or to the way that we live. But Father, we stand under your word as a fountain of living water. And Lord, we declare our need for your spirit to help us understand your word. We also declare our dependence on your spirit to live out truth and the obligations of the gospel as it calls us to obedience. And so Lord, I do pray that in this short time that we have together, you would do a great work in our minds and hearts. And it's in Christ Jesus' name that I pray. Amen. Right, well, we should be talking about generosity, but as I said, we will begin by thinking about generosity in the world. Generosity in the world, that's our first point on the outline. Because when we think about generosity, there is one generosity that appears in the world, there's another generosity that appears in Christ, and those two are very different. It's because you have different mindsets and different relationships within those two separate spheres. If we think of the worldly sphere for a second, worldly relationships of giving and receiving, of exchange, this is all what we talk about when we say generosity. You can understand worldly relationships as a line. This is the physical reality. I will talk about this later, but relationships in Christ can be likened to a circle. Now, what do I mean by a line? I mean, this is the physical reality of relationships in everyday world. In everyday world, you have people who give to others, but they give to others with wrong motives. So you probably have experienced this in your life where you've received from someone who wants to just be superior over you. Have you experienced that? It's supposed to be a gift of generosity, but instead it makes you feel inferior to that person, indebted to that person. Sometimes worldly relationships can be characterized, and this might be a caricature, but they give in order to be superior. That's one aspect of worldly generosity. A second aspect of worldly generosity is that they declare themselves, whether they say it or not, as the source of what they give. They are the source of their generosity because they don't believe in God, which we'll come back to that. And thirdly, they determine what to do with what they own or what they give. Right? Every gift has a purpose. Every gift of generosity has a purpose. And they determine the purpose of their gifts. So one, they see themselves as the source of their gift. Two, they determine the purpose of their gift. And three, most times, the purpose is to be superior over another. Now that's the physical reality of worldly relationships. What's the spiritual reality? The spiritual reality is that man, apart from Christ, I know you guys love my stick figures, is curved in on himself. We have the Latin phrase, homo man, incurvatus, curved in, in se, on himself. Man curved in on himself. Augustine started that. Luther expounded on it. And all it shows is the spiritual reality of everyone who is in the world. So whatever their generosity might look like, empirically or in the physical realm, spiritually speaking, they're curved in on themselves, and that's why we have those three aspects of worldly generosity. They are the source of their giving. They determine what their gifts are for. And oftentimes, it's to be superior over another. We're going to come back to those three things when we think about relationships of generosity in Christ. Now, this really is a one-way kind of gift. And what I want to emphasize in the contrast is one-way giving shouldn't even be present in the church. Reciprocity, the word reciprocity, entails a giving and receiving, right? Everyone who's alive desires relationship. Do you all desire relationship in this room right now? RBC students desire relationships, sometimes too much that they neglect their studies and they start looking for a spouse. But that aside, we all desire relationships. And every single relationship is a give and take relationship, isn't it? It's not one way. It can't be one way, right? If a lover loves someone else and they don't reciprocate their love, we don't call that person a lover, we call that person a stalker. Right? It's one way. It needs to be matched. It needs to be matched by love, right? So reciprocity is a critical component here. And we have a circle instead of a line. Because what happens when the grace of God comes? First, we have to talk about what grace is. I don't want to skip that very important point. The word grace, didn't know how to spell it. Sure you do, but grace is often understood as God's riches at Christ's expense. Have you heard that phrase? Right. There are different ways to understand grace, but what I want to challenge you with is that sometimes we misunderstand the word grace on its own. Grace is the Greek word is charis. You might have called your or named your daughter Charis. You've called her Grace. What grace means at the simplest level is gift. That's all the word means. Gift. So, we can start there. It is just gift. What determines what that gift is, or what that gift looks like, or what it does, is the context around each instance of the word charis. And so let's start there and just describe this as gift. Now, what is this gift according to Scripture? Well, like I said before, that word encompasses everything that we have that's ours in Christ. Herman Bovink says it really well. He says, all the benefits of the covenant that Christ acquired and the Holy Spirit applies can be summed up in the word grace. But we have to know that grace means different things to different people. So, for example, one common interpretation is undeserved favor, right? And that is so true. There is nothing that you do to earn grace. If you do, what is it? Not grace. Right? So for it something to be of grace, it has to be given to those who do not deserve it. Now, that's going to be a critical point that I want to come back to. What else is grace? Grace is divine disposition. What do I mean by that? Divine disposition is how God looks upon you. He looks favorably upon you. He has a gracious disposition toward those who receive grace. So it's undeserved favor, divine disposition, and we have many instances of that within Scripture. So look with me, for example. Well, you don't have to turn there, but I can read it for you. Romans 3:24. This is a glorious text where he contrasts those who are under the law and those who are under grace. And in 3:21, he introduces this righteousness of God. And expounding upon it, he says in chapter 3, verse 24, those are justified and are justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. We have there linking grace and gift. That confirms our understanding of grace, but it goes farther than that. It says that through the redemption that's in Christ Jesus, God can look favorably upon us, and we know that from Romans chapter 5, verse 1. We have peace with God, right? So that's what results in the gift of grace. Romans chapter 5, verse 15 and 17. Again, but the free gift, notice how it contrasts gift and grace, but the free gift is not like the trespass. For if many died through one man's trespass, much more have the grace of God and the free gift by the grace of that one man, Jesus Christ. Notice that. Grace, gift, grace. And it abounded for many. Verse 17, for if because of one man's trespass, death reigned through that one man, much more will those who receive the abundance of grace and the free gift of righteousness reign in life through the one man, Jesus Christ. Common text that we all know is Ephesians 2:8. You could probably quote it. For by grace you have been saved through faith. And this, not of your own doing, it is what? Gift from God. So it is a gift. It is the gift of God. Grace is a gift. But it's also a material gift. So although it could be a spiritual gift like salvation, it could be an actual physical gift that you give to another person, right? So for example, in the text that we're going to spend some time in a little bit later, we're going to read 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 1, where it speaks of the spiritual grace of God, and then we're going to see how that word grace appears all throughout those chapters. Think about 7 times the word grace appears. But you can't pick that up because the English will render it differently. But there, the gift of the Gentiles to the Jews, the physical gift of money, Paul calls that grace. Paul calls that grace. Now, in the ancient world, this is nothing new. In the ancient world, if you read the major treaties on gift-giving, which was written by Seneca, he talks about gift more than you probably want to read about. But in that text, he shows how grace, the word charis, or really for him it's Latin, gratia, how the word grace in the ancient world, and you see this in other places like Epictetus and Aristotle, is a word for gift. So, for example, let me just show you. When you give a charis, you give it to another person, that's the gift in the ancient world, right? When you return something, you give eucharistia. Now, notice what word is in there, right? So this is what the ancient world, this is the word, anyone know? Eucharistia, none of my students.
Eucharist.
Thanksgiving. That's what the word means, Thanksgiving. So in the ancient world, you give a charis and you get eucharistia back. They called this the circle of grace. The circle of grace. And this is how relationships were bound together. And so one gives a gift, the other one gives thanks in return. This was very common. Same thing in the New Testament. The same words are used when talking about the gift of God, charis. When giving thanks back to the giver, guess what word's used? Eucharistia, thanksgiving. We have the circle of grace in the New Testament. So it aligns with the ancient world. Well, great. But Christianity is unique. It's unlike relationships of gift in the ancient world. Let me give you two differences. The first is that you got to ask the question, to whom should I give a charis, a gift? Do you think that you should give to someone who was unworthy, ungodly? No, not at all. In the ancient world, that was not using your gifts in a way that accords with reason. If you're going to give a gift to someone, you can only and you should only give to those who deserve it, those who are worthy. Now, think of the contrast with Romans chapter 4, verse 5. God gives the gift of salvation, of righteousness, to the ungodly. So, huge difference there. You deserve a gift in the ancient world. You do not deserve a gift in Christ. A second difference, and this relates to unpacking a definition of grace, is that grace is not only an undeserved favor. Grace is not only a physical and spiritual gift, which we can add there, the physical gift of money or resource. Grace is not just divine disposition. It's even more glorious. Grace is a person. Grace is a person. Guess what person? Or guess who? Yeah, Sunday school answer. Jesus. That's right. Now, he is a person. Grace is a person. John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son. He gave his only son as a gift. Galatians 2. Do you want to turn there? We'll look at Galatians for a little bit. Galatians 2, verse 20. Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself up for me. Jesus Christ is the very embodiment of grace. He is grace incarnated, or grace incarnate. And what Paul does in Galatians chapter 5, verse 4, is further substantiate that claim. In chapter 5, verse 4, when he talks about being severed from Christ, notice the contrast here. Galatians 5, verse 4, "You are severed from Christ, you who would be justified by the law." Notice, "you have fallen away from grace." He links grace and Christ together because Jesus Christ is the very embodiment of grace. 2 Corinthians 8, 9, and we'll look at this text a little bit later, says, "For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ." And let this sink in for a second. Let this sink in for a second. You know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. Well, what is it? "That because he was rich, yet for your sake he became poor, so that you, through his poverty, might become rich." That is the essence of grace, the person and work of Jesus Christ. Along those lines, I'd like to read, I don't know if you have the Valley of Vision, but if you don't have a copy of the Valley of Vision, go buy it from the bookstore. It is so spiritually edifying and so theologically rich. But there's this Valley of Vision, a prayer called the Gift of Gifts. I want to read it to you. "O source of all good, what shall I render to thee for the gift of gifts? Thine own dear Son, begotten, not created, my Redeemer, proxy, surety, substitute, his self-emptying, incomprehensible, his infinity of love beyond the heart's grasp. Herein is wonder of wonders. He came below to raise me above, was born like me that I might become like him. Herein is love. When I cannot rise to him, he draws near on wings of grace to raise me to himself. Herein is power. When deity and humanity were infinitely apart, he united them in an inseparable unity, the uncreated and the created. Herein is wisdom. When I was undone, with no will to return to him, and no intellect to devise recovery, he came, God incarnate, to save me to the uttermost, as man to die my death, to shed satisfying blood on my behalf, to work out a perfect righteousness for me. O God, take me in spirit to the watchful shepherds and enlarge my mind. Let me hear good tidings of great joy, and hearing believe, rejoice, praise, adore. My conscience bathed in an ocean of repose, my eyes uplifted to a reconciled Father. Place me with ox and donkey, camel, goat, to look with them upon my Redeemer's face and in him account myself delivered from sin. Let me with Simeon clasp the newborn child to my heart, embrace him with undying faith, exulting that he is mine and I am his. In him thou hast given me so much that heaven can give no more." The embodiment of grace in the greatest of all gifts, the person of Jesus Christ. But there's more. There's more to grace that we sometimes miss out on. And it is the fact that grace is not only these things, it's also power. Power. Let me prove that to you in the text. 2 Corinthians 12, 9. You're familiar with this text. "But he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in your weakness." Grace and power there are juxtaposed. It is grace that empowers Paul to push through the weakness and even identify his weakness as the power of God as he is identified with Christ. 1 Corinthians 15:10 as well. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace toward me was not in vain. On the contrary, notice, I worked harder. How did he work harder? By the grace of God. I worked harder than any of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that was with me. So this is a more fuller picture of what grace is. The word itself only means gift, and yet there's several aspects that we need to keep in mind in order to understand God's grace. Now, we can move on from what is grace to the second question, which is, what does grace do? What does it do? Well, the first thing that you should notice, first thing that grace does is that it unites you to Christ. It unites you to Christ. Second thing it does is makes you a new creation. So if you're taking notes, you can quickly jot that down. And right next to those two points, it unites us to Christ and it makes us new creations. There's one key text to confirm that. 2 Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, literally in the original, it just says new creation. If anyone is in Christ, new creation. The old has passed away, the new has come. Now, what is this new? What is this new creation? Is it me as an individual? Or is it some place that I enter into that we call new creation? Is it primarily anthropological, meaning dealing with the person as an individual? Or does it deal with the sphere, a new creation that we enter into? What do you think I'm going to say? Yes. Yes, it's both. It is a new creation as an individual, but you enter into a new sphere that we call the new creation, both now and not yet. So Gerhardus Voss has a great quote that I'd like to read to you as he expounds on what this means. What does this text mean? 2 Corinthians 5:17. For the one who has undergone this experience of having become in Christ, Voss says, not merely individual subjective conditions have changed, that's the individual anthropological element, but the old things are passed away, new things have come into being. There has been created a totally new environment, or more accurately speaking, a totally new world in which the person spoken of is an inhabitant and a participator. So yes, you change into a new creation. You're no longer like this. You're no longer homo incurvatus sensei. You're no longer curved in on yourself. Guess what you are? You're homo excurvatus exe, curved out toward God and others. You are curved out toward God and others. And this is where we begin to think about relating to one another and understanding each other in Christ. Union with Christ is one of the most beautiful doctrines. I hope that whether on a scholarly level or popular level, you are reading about union with Christ, because it will change the way that you view yourself, change the way that you understand even your own worth, and it has great practical ramifications if you rightly understand union with Christ. Now, on the back of your handout, I've given you several quotes that I would like to read through. John Murray has a great quote to begin with. Nothing is more central or basic than union and communion with Christ. Nothing. That's a bold statement. The Westminster Larger Catechism asks the question, what is the union that the elect have with Christ? The answer, the union which the elect have with Christ is the work of God's grace, whereby they are spiritually and mystically, yet really and inseparably, joined to Christ as their head and husband, which is done in their effectual calling. Loaded, and I can't expound. I'm going to quickly move on, and you can ask questions later. John Calvin says this about union with Christ: we must understand that as long as Christ remains outside of us and we are separated from him, all that he has suffered and done for the salvation of the human race remains useless and of no value to us. Union with Christ is how we participate, embrace, treasure Jesus Christ's person, and all of his work is counted to our account. His righteousness is imputed to us by faith. Now, union with Christ makes us new creations and it curves us out toward God. In thankfulness, we can now see his gift that he's given to us in Jesus Christ, clearly in the gospel. And we embrace that gospel and we say, thank you, Lord, because I see Christ no longer as an object to be ashamed of or to revile or to hate or to be hostile against, no longer as an enemy. I've been made a new creation, so I embrace him as the embodiment of gift, and I'm united to him. But guess what? I'm not the only one who's united to Christ. Are you united to Christ? Right? How many people are in this room? I don't know. 40? We don't have 40 Christs, do we? There's one Christ. So one Christ, and yet we're all united to him. What do you think that means for us?
Communion.
Communion, exactly. Fellowship. Koinonia. Relationship. We are therefore united to one another. That's the third aspect. That's the third thing that grace does, is that it not only unites us to Christ, not only makes us new creations, right, but, and brings us into new creation, but it unites us to one another. 1 John, and this is on the back of your handout, 1 John chapter 1, verse 5 is a great text because it's surprising. He doesn't say what you think he's going to say, and then all of a sudden, my heart leaps every single time I read this text. God, and this on the handout, page 2, 1 John, it's the fourth quote down. God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. If we say we have fellowship, that is koinonia, if we say we have fellowship with him, God, while we walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. But if we walk in the light as he, who's he? God. If we walk in the light as God is in the light, we have fellowship with, you would think, he would say God. But what does he say? One another. One another. And the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. So we are curved out toward God and one another, and this sets up the context, the theological context, for looking at generosity, finally, in the early church. We have God. You and others. Now, if you look over at 2 Corinthians chapter 8, it's also on your handout on the back. I actually have the key text that I'm going to draw out if you're overwhelmed by two long chapters. I want to now quickly look at relationships in Christ, relationships of generosity in Christ. Talked about God's grace, talked about what grace does, and now we've set the context for what do relationships of generosity look like in Christ, in this new world we inhabit and participate in. Surprisingly, the clearest description of Paul's theology of relationships is found in this text, 2 Corinthians 8, 9, which is not one that you actually go to for devotions most times. You know, you're going to go to Psalms or go elsewhere. It's not really one that you might go to for theology, because all it describes is how Paul went around to different churches and collected money from different Gentiles to give to the poor saints in Jerusalem. You may be familiar with this. It talks about it in Romans chapter 15. Talks about in Galatians 2:10, arguably, 1 Corinthians 16, and here in 2 Corinthians 8 and 9. Now, in 2 Corinthians 8, it's fascinating how he describes the two dimensions. One is the vertical, and the other is the horizontal. And those are the two dimensions that I'd like to look with you, look through this text and see what it tells us. Now, the collection was very important for horizontal relationships, and it was really important because there were those who were in need and those who had something to give. But the way that Paul begins this appeal in 2 Corinthians chapter 8 is by focusing on what God has done. Now, this is critical for generosity. Do you want to know how you can become a generous person? You don't pull yourself up by your moral bootstraps and get to work and try to feel that desire, you know, on your own. No. The way that you become a more generous person is by dwelling more and more on the generosity of God in Christ. And this is exactly what Paul does. It's the critical point. This whole text focuses in on the circle of grace and what God has done. Note this. Look at 2 Corinthians chapter 1, 2 Corinthians 8, 1, when it says, sorry, I was in 1 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 1 says, "We want you to know, brothers, about what? The grace of God that has been given among the churches of Macedonia." That's the Philippians and Thessalonians. Now, that's the circle of grace, right? The first part. Charis has been given. And turn to chapter 9, verse 15, at the end of this section. Paul says, "Thanks be to God for his inexpressible gift." So this whole section is bookended by the circle of grace. And here it's not Eucharistia that's given in return, it's also charis. But you still have a circle of grace, right? Charis for charis, charis, Eucharistia. And within this, then he just kind of crafts his appeal, because notice what Paul says, "Thanks be to God for his inexpressible gift." Well, why is he so excited? Why is there an exclamation point in your English translation? Because he's excited about the gift in chapter 8, verse 9. "You know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that because he was rich, he became poor so that you through his poverty might become rich." That's what he's excited about. And he wants you to be excited about that, so that the divine grace of God in Christ, as it comes down, right, in the form of charis, produces thanksgiving in your heart, not only to God, but also extends in grace. So, God, for your first point, and I think I've given you space to do some drawings yourself, if you like to draw. I'm not exactly sure. Did I give you space for that? If I did, you can begin to draw little figurines, and I get really excited because that's just the way I think, is by drawing these little diagrams. But God's grace, this initial divine generosity, sets the tone and even produces the generosity that you give to others. It must. If not, you're no different than those in worldly relationships. Let me think of some text with me. What do you have that you did not receive? And if you did receive it, why do you boast as if you didn't? Right? So 1 Corinthians 2, 14, I believe. 4, 7. It's like 1 Corinthians 4, 7. What do you have that you did not receive? The answer is nothing. You have nothing that you have not received. Did you give birth to yourself? No? Did you give life to yourself? Did you give yourself your own intellect? Did you give yourself your own gifts that have been naturally cultivated? Right? No, none of those things are yours. You are not the source of those things at all. Romans 11, 36, "For from him and through him and to him are some things, all things, everything is from God, through God, to God." And so we are not the source. We are mediators. We are channels. We are those who only give what we've received. Right? And that becomes clear in 2 Corinthians as well. In 2 Corinthians 8, 1, it talks about God's grace. And then immediately in verse 3, it says, "they gave." You know about the grace of God they've received, and then they gave. clearly indicating that there's one movement from God to man and then another movement from man to man in generosity. And notice how he crafts it. For in a severe test of affliction, and this is chapter 8, verse 2, their abundance of joy and their extreme poverty have overflowed in a wealth of generosity. That's fascinating, and you can spend a long time on that. How do you give when you're impoverished? Right? Well, here, we have to be reminded that you not only, it's not only the rich in the church that can give. Right? We all know that. There are plenty of people who are poor. You students who are poor right now in this stage of life have plenty to give. Because in Christ, it's not just about the physical. It's also about the spiritual. And that can revolutionize the way that we think of fellowship. But I digress. Interestingly enough, there are only two occurrences of the phrase grace of God in 2 Corinthians 8 and 9. In 8:1, it refers to God's giving, God's generosity. But then if you turn to chapter 9, verse 14, it refers to human giving. So the two are tied. And if we look at chapter 9, verse 14, it says, while they long for you and pray for you because of the surpassing grace of God upon you. And then also in chapter 9, verse 8, we see that there is a mediation. It says in chapter 9, verse 8, after saying that God loves a cheerful giver, and God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that having all sufficiency in all times, you may abound in every good work. Every single good work. And then in 9:11, you will be enriched in every way to be generous in every way, which through us will produce thanksgiving to God. Take all those verses together, and what you find is that grace is given to them in 2 Corinthians 8:1, right? Grace is given to us in Christ in the gospel, and we mediate that same grace that can be physical or spiritual. And according to 9:11, what it produces in people is what?
Thanksgiving.
Thanksgiving. Eucharistia, or thanksgiving. This is the circle of grace. But remember the illustration of the stalker, right? One-way giving is no giving at all. You know why? Because giving has the intent or the purpose of creating relationships. Relationships of reciprocity, of generosity toward one another. I might get in trouble here, but this is why I think that anonymous gifts are bad. I know that they tend to have this facade of piety, because what people will often say is, well, I want to give in the same way that God gives, right? With no strings attached. And by removing any identity to this gift that I'm giving, then I give in a more pure way. Right? That's not Christian. That's Nietzsche. Nietzsche taught that to give a gift and to think of anything, any self-interest whatsoever, is to necessarily corrupt this gift and it no longer becomes a gift. Does God give with strings attached? Pretty sure he does. I'll have to unpack that and qualify it. But yes, he gives grace to those who do not deserve it. He gives grace apart from any works whatsoever. But he produces within you, because grace is power, the ability to meet his demands. Right? So he does. So that's why I don't think anonymous giving is very helpful. Because it totally cuts off any relationship whatsoever. Well, who put this in my box? Happens to me quite a bit. I'll get a little gift in the box, and I'm like, well, who gave it to me? I want to thank them. I want to be in relationship with them. I want that gift to contribute to how we see one another and how we give to one another. That's important. And so this is the kind of giving that we give. And when we look at this, it seems like one-way giving, right? This person's a mediator, and he gives to this person. And it's full stop. They just give thanks to God. The fascinating thing about 2 Corinthians, if you look over at chapter 8, and I'll try to end with this, 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 13, is that the circle actually turns back on itself.
And it also presupposes that this will happen.
Because after all, one-way relationships are no relationships. It's not a relationship at all. So in 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 13, when he's using the example of the Macedonians to compel or to incite the Corinthians to give, he says this about it. He does not mean, for I do not mean, this is verse 13, that others should be eased and you burdened, but that as a matter of fairness, notice that, that word is equality, as a matter of equality, your abundance at the present time should supply their need, so that their abundance may supply your need, that there may be fairness or equality. All right, let me ask you a question. If this is party A and this is party B, would this be abundance or would this be abundance? If I have a lot, I think of the little diagrams that I draw. Hi, abundance, what's need? Down, okay, is that equality? Okay, so Paul says, I don't mean that I want you to be in giving in abundance and only to their need, but so that someday they can give when you're in need. Is that equality? So what's Paul thinking about? It's only equality if they're giving back and forth, but they are not the source of what they're giving. It's only equality if God is the source of what each party is giving. So here we see the direct contrast with the way of the world. The way of the world, each person is the source. You're in Christ. Are you the source? No, you can never be the source. God is the source. What are you then? You're a mediator. You only give what you have received. And for what purpose? So that you can be above people? No. It's so that there may be equality. A giving and receiving and a relationship of generosity that goes back and forth between two people. And guess who gets all the glory? God. He gets all the glory. And so whether this is you talking about your own possessions, this is whether or not it's you talking about the things that you've accomplished, all that you have is gift. If you actually, I'm convinced of this, if you actually live your life that way, you will be a far more generous person. If you take every single moment and you say, this is a gift from God, this class session was a gift to me. And I praise God for it because I'm able to revel with you in the gospel of Jesus Christ and the kind of relationships that the gospel creates. If we just think this way, I guarantee you, we will be a more generous people. Not only in giving money, but giving time, listening, encouraging, caring for our brothers and sisters and their sanctification. That we strive hard in our own sanctification, knowing that when they come to us and they're down, I want to be ready for a word to encourage them and to lift them up. We will strive hard to be generous in every way for the purpose of making much of God and not ourselves. All right, let me pray. Seems fitting, and we'll conclude our time together. Father, we thank you so much for the grace that is found in our Lord Jesus Christ, and I pray that as we know this grace, as we learn about this grace, as we know it not only intellectually but experientially, we experience this grace on a day-to-day basis, that we would be even more generous, having seen the generosity that you have exemplified in your Son, Jesus Christ. And I pray for everyone in here that you would be so glorified in their lives, Lord, that they would dedicate their lives as sacrificial offering, giving themselves to you in a life of thanksgiving for the grace that they have received. Pray that you bless the rest of our time at this conference, and may you be glorified. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.